peanut butter cups. And welcome to Fifth Third Arena here in Cincinnati, the Big O's old stomping grounds, as the Bearcats host number 7 Marquette on senior night for UC. They have packed the house to bid a final farewell to Dion, Dixon, and Yancy Gates. These two seniors playing their final home game in a Bearcat uniform tonight. Both 1,000-point scorers here at Cincinnati, and both hoping to cap their senior seasons with a trip to the NCAA tournament. Both will cap their senior seasons with a trip to Madison Square Garden next week and the Big East tournament, which is on the horizon for Cincinnati, who needs some help, but they could still possibly get a double bye next week. That's not something Marquette has to worry about. A terrific year for the Golden Eagles. Already a program record in the Big East, 13 wins at 13-3. They have clinched a double bye when the Big East goes to the Garden next week. Hi again, everyone. Bob Wischusen alongside Bob Knight. Thanks for spending part of your night with us. It took until early Tuesday morning for them to finally wrap up the Daytona 500. If you haven't seen Marquette play yet this year, you might think Daytona is still going, because we talked to Mick Cronin about it before the game. This is a team that can get end-to-end in a hurry.
Well, not only do they do it in a hurry, Bob, they do it well. They get there with good spacing. They have good shot selection. They don't throw the ball away. We're going to see a couple of steals here where they take it all the way to the bucket. But they look for people, too. Man with the ball is always looking, just like there, when he's got somebody open. And Cincinnati is going to have a defensive break that's the equal of Marquette's offensive break to have a chance to win this ball game.
These two teams met earlier this season, earlier in mid-February, as a matter of fact, and Marquette basically ran Cincinnati off the floor. They were down 16-4 to start the game and ended up winning 95-78. They're the best team in transition points-wise in the Big East, and they scored 31 transition points against the Bearcats in the win in Milwaukee. As we take a look at the starting lineups, once again, Devontae Gardner will miss tonight's game for Marquette, out with a left knee sprain, so they will rely heavily in the front court on Jay Crowder, who has been the conference player of the week 2 weeks in a row, making a late push to maybe get some consideration for Big East player of the year. And of course, Darius Johnson Odom has had a terrific season thus far, as has Sean Kilpatrick, averaging just a shade under 15 points a game for Cincinnati. Buzz Williams, in his fourth season, has won 22 or more games all 4 years he's been at Marquette, and he might have the best team that he's had yet at Marquette this year.
Well, I think that Mick Cronin has done a great job at Cincinnati. I think we have two coaches here that, first of all, really enjoy basketball. It's been a big part of their lives, and I think their teams will show in this ball game, Bob, just how much work they put into it.
Marquette has won 5 in a row and 12 of their last 13. Cincinnati has won 5 of their last 7, but they are coming off of a 1-point loss that didn't get out of the 40s against South Florida over the weekend.
Marquette really moves well to help on defense, right? Just like he did there. Really moved, good move.
Still in the corner, it's Kilpatrick that hits a triple to get Cincinnati off to the quick start.
Johnson Odom needed to recover just a little bit quicker than he did.
Nancy Gates with the takeaway.
See if Cincinnati, how long they stay and continue to play defense effectively in that 2-3 zone.
Gates, an offensive rebound, forces it back up. And it ends up in the hands of Jamil Wilson. Vander Blue, a kick out to DJ O. And he knocks it down. We're tied at 3.
That's the thing that they do very quickly. You get the defense back, and the defense worries about the drive, and the shooter sets open, and they look for people. When you've got the ball in the Marquette uniform, you're looking for somebody that's open.
That 3 is just a little too strong for Kashmir Wright. And here comes Vander Blue. And Odom again. He hits another triple, and that puts Marquette on top.
Blue did a really good job of forcing that zone back toward the baseline, and when he dropped it off for the shot, plenty of time, plenty of room to take the shot.
Kilpatrick with a floater. That's a pretty move by Sean Kilpatrick. Cadugan with the hit ahead in traffic looking for Crowder, broken up again by Gates. Gates on the baseline. And the rebound fought for and won in traffic by JaQuon Parker. Back outside, Kilpatrick can't hit. Gates keeps it alive again. Muscles it up, and a foul call.
Gates has done a great job on that defensive backboard thus far, Bob. He's come up with it three times. Two of them led the baskets.
Well, Marquette's without Chris Atule, their 6'11" junior center who tore his ACL earlier this year. Devontae Gardner's been out for the last seven games. So if there's a knock against Marquette, they don't have a lot of size in the front court. Can you win going through the spring with the type of lineup that Buzz Williams puts on the floor every night?
Well, I think they can, but yet they're going to have to play almost error-free basketball with their break. And they've done a good job with that. And there's no reason why they don't continue. But I think no matter what they've got or who they've got out there, who's hurt and who isn't, offensive conversion is the key to Marquette offense, the key to their team. There's that zone again. They're going to stay in that zone and try to make Marquette spend some time with the ball.
Crowder tries a three. They don't spend much time as he knocks down another.
I think he knocked that three down. It tickled me. Most everybody's so tickled they made a three, and he looked immediately at the official saying, I got a foul on that one. I should have had four on it out.
Parker from the wing. Gates another offensive rebound, but a foul call. That'll be Gates for pushing Wilson in the back.
Here we're going to see Crowder step into the shot. He had a lot of room. Delivered the ball very easily. Kids have long ago, Bob, become accustomed to the distance of the three-point shot. They shoot it as easily today as kids used to shoot it from 15 feet. They screen a little bit against the zone.
Vander Blue can't hit. Another rebound for Gates.
It'd be big for Cincinnati if they can continue to have the same control over the defensive board as they've had so far.
Shot clock down to 10. Kilpatrick to the wing, right. Shot clock at 7 with a floater from a long way away. And it's up in the air and tapped back by Gates. Sets up right for 3. Gates kept it alive on the offensive glass again. Rips it away. Already 5 rebounds for Yancy Gates. But then he turns it over. Another foul on Gates.
I think 2 fouls now. He's done a great job on the board. But I'll tell you, just in what we've looked at so far, Marquette does as good a job helping on defense as any team I've seen.
Great effort by Gates, but he picks up the 2nd foul, so he's on the bench now as Jack Mudge has come on. Once again. Down to 5 for Johnson Odom. Into the post it goes. Wilson, tough turnaround. Comes up short. Tapped out of bounds. Over to Cincinnati when we return. So Marquette with 9 full hill. Where will he be tomorrow? Follow the tour on Twitter at Jay Billis and at ESPN Home Court to find out. Is Jay insulting those in cubicles around the country all week? If we all had the job that Jay has of got to go to work, it's a different college basketball game every night. And I imagine he might wrap it up with that Duke North Carolina game coming up this weekend. Vaughn Parker attacks and a hand check up top. Called against Jamil Wilson. That's his 2nd foul. So not much front court depth, coach, for Marquette. They have a big man now, or at least their version of a big man. Jamil Wilson in foul trouble with a couple, and Nick Cronin has already put Yancy Gates on the bench with two. Did you always have a tried and true formula with how quickly you would take a big man with two fouls out of a game?
Well, not really. Really, to me, it depended on where we were in the game, what the score was, what are we playing against, what do we need. I really didn't have any set things that we did, Bob. A lot of what I did was just based on experience and what had worked for us.
Well, after Parker ties it, here's Dixon ahead of the field. Missed the dunk, and then could have gotten called for hanging on the rim. Wilson the other way throws it down.
That was a really bad waste, Cincinnati, of a great defensive play at the other end.
Kilpatrick able to answer. And we're tied at 11 once again as Buzz Williams goes to his bench.
That was preceded by an excellent defensive play at the other end. And then Marquette stayed back a little bit and were almost impossible to cover on that turnover from the rebound.
There goes Junior Cadugan. Finds Anderson, who just checked in. He's rejected by Moj. Dixon on the outlet has it stripped away. But stepping on the sideline was Jay Crowder as he attempted the steal. Excellent play by Sheck Mudge on the block. Parker drives again. Scores.
Now that's the first time tonight Cincinnati's had some good drives, but that's the first time that Marquette has failed to help on defense, and they got all the way to the bucket.
Crowder looked underneath and couldn't connect with Juan Anderson.
We're going to get a look at it. Here he turns the corner. And no help that time. He gets all the way to the bucket. It's a real good hesitation move.
I was listening to a game you were doing either earlier this week or last week, and you were talking about the restricted area rule and how you think it might impact teams and how they can help defensively.
Well, first of all, I thought that badminton people had put the rule in basketball. I thought it was about as useless a rule as I'd ever seen.
Dixon able to connect. Johnson Odom pulls up at the other end. That missed everything.
Cincinnati's done a good job, Bob, of not just going pell-mell from end to end. They're trying to get some quickness into their movement, but they're also very good settling down and running an offense.
Another offensive rebound, but a miss by Kilpatrick. Mayo pulls up. That's no good. Crowder's going to be called for a foul. Pulling Cashmere right. That's his first.
It always amazes me when a kid commits a foul. The foul is called, and he wonders why it was called. He had him almost with both hands on his shoulders. Yeah, and he's got a piece of his shirt right here.
Justin Jackson comes on for the first time for Cincinnati, as does Jelon Gwynn. So Cashmere Wright goes to the bench with JaQuon Parker for the Bearcats. Gwynn left alone for three. In and out.
Well, we've had three shots taken by Cincinnati under pressure where a little shot fake eliminates all that.
Cadugan drives from behind. Jackson got a piece.
Good move. Good move setting it up.
And Dixon drives it. Lays it in over Crowder.
Crowder really didn't come out at him. He let Dixon come to him. And consequently, Dixon got all the way to the bucket. Great shot fake right there.
Mayo with an air ball after Johnson Odom set him up beautifully.
Well, that was a good setup.
Cincinnati with their largest lead early at six. And Kilpatrick for three. Sheck Mudge had it taken away by Mayo. Crowder, broken up by Kilpatrick, and we'll have a timeout. 6-point lead for Cincinnati.
I'm going to get a good look at penetration right here. Pulling up a little bit short. Need help to stop them.
None but for the Big East if it began today. The first round matchups, DePaul, West Virginia, Pittsburgh, Rutgers, Providence, Connecticut, and Villanova, St. John's. And moving on to take on maybe USF, one of the surprise teams this year in the Big East. Marquette has already earned the double bye. This, of course, could change between now and the weekend. Bob Wischusen and Bob Knight back at Cincinnati. The coat has come off for Buzz Williams, a team that's already set a program record for most wins of the Big East in Marquette history with 13 this season, and they will certainly be a threat next week at the Garden.
Well, I think Marquette is going to be a threat until the season's over. Cincinnati's done a good job in their zone. They've come out on, pressured the shooters. They've virtually eliminated the ball going inside to any Marquette postman inside. They've done a really good job with it. Don't want to put it in the corner unless he's open to shoot it.
Shot clock at 7. Crowder out of the post, finds Mayo back cutting. Another turnover. Saved underneath by Kilpatrick. And goes away from the screen and lays it in.
There's that defensive help that was needed, and Marquette's not getting it. They started out with it real well, but now they've been burned twice without help.
Crowder with a nice look underneath and able to connect with Vanderbloom.
Yeah, Crowder made that move. Bob, he wasn't just concentrating on getting to the bucket and maybe throwing up a bad shot. He had the whole court in vision from where he was, and that's what resulted in a good pass. Good vision, know where your teammates are.
Tapped out of bounds by Jackson off the Kilpatrick miss. That last bucket for Marquette ended a 10-0 Cincinnati run in a stretch where Marquette hadn't made a field goal in 5 consecutive trips.
I think what Cincinnati has done, and you've indicated this, that they've done so well, is take the ball to the bucket, but they've done it with some patience. Now there was maybe the third time they've taken a shot too quickly. Cincinnati needs to look and move and look to penetrate on every offensive possession rather than relying on the shot to begin with.
Vanderbloom fouled underneath by Jackson, his first. Well, for a team that like Marquette that's so good in transition, what does Cincinnati have to do to get them in the half court?
Well, I think scoring is one way, and they have driven the ball well. They've had good patience. I don't think they need to shoot the ball from outside until the last 10 seconds of the possession because they've had these opportunities to drive.
Dixon tried to drive it, but it was knocked away. Cashmere right. A foul is called. Darius Johnson Odom called for the foul as Cashmere Wright jumped in. Had a path towards the steal and bodied down by Odom. That's his first.
Good call. Marquette's going to have to penetrate against that zone to bring two people to the ball and then look for shooters after that. So many times people think, and it was an old concept in basketball, Bob, that pass the ball against the zone, pass, pass, pass. I think that you use the pass fake. Make a dribble, fake, throw it another direction, and look to dribble penetrate into the gaps of the zone. Bringing two guys to the ball, and then that means you're playing 4-on-3 elsewhere, and I think that's what Cincinnati is able to do right now. Marquette is not penetrating.
There's Parker again on the drive.
If they take their time, that's about the 5th or 6th bucket they've gotten on the drive. They just need to exploit it on every possession.
Johnson Odom from way outside. That's too strong. Uncontested rebound to Justin Jackson. Dixon for 3. Off the mark.
See, that's not what I think that you'd want Cincinnati doing, because they've gotten so much out of patience.
Second effort by Johnson Odom as well. Well, Cincinnati made their first three. They've missed their next 10. So they're now 1 for 11 here in the first half from three. And yet they still have a 6-point lead. Dixon set up. 11 misses in a row from behind the arc, but an offensive rebound for Parker, and he'll go to the line.
That was the kind of situation, Bob, that I really wanted, and not just wanted, but I demanded the shot fake. The ball is reversed. The defense is coming out on the ball, coming toward the ball. Little shot fake lifts the defense up, and now you're past that defensive man, playing 5 against 4, and you're going to get a good shot out of it. The defense is the most overlooked and underworked single offensive move in basketball.
We were talking during the break, and I'm not sure how much this has changed in your opinion over the years, but how much more athletic defenses are now than they've ever been, and as a result, maybe how much more that shot fake could help.
Well, a really good athlete years ago was not a good athlete compared to the athletes across the board that we have playing today, and yet you can work that to your advantage. The good athlete is anxious to get the ball, to block a shot, and a lot of times the defense is over aggressive and you get one guy off of his feet and you're able to play 5-on-4, and that's exactly what Marquette did there. They missed the bucket, but they got penetration.
Seemed like Crowder lost the handle on the way up. Another three, though, missed by Parker.
How many is that now, Bob, that they've missed?
Well, they're 1 for 13 here in the first half.
Right, that's 12 possessions that they got nothing out of but a shot. They didn't get to the line. There was no possibility of going to the line with that 3-point shot. And if they mix it up a little bit, let's say they took 7 of those possessions, probably 4 or 5 of them that had gotten to the bucket or been on the free throw line.
Well, they shoot more threes and make more than any team in the Big East does Cincinnati, but they were 3 for 13 from behind the arc in the loss, and a lopsided loss it was at that to Marquette and Milwaukee.
Well, even though you've got a good record with it, when it's not going for you, you just got to give it up. Now, don't stay with something. Don't stay with the same fly that's not catching fish.
Especially if the other fly is working, right? They're driving the ball well. Reach-in foul called on Jalon Gwynn. Will step aside. 8-point lead for Cincinnati in spite of Nick Cronin's team struggling behind the arc.
A moment ago, it's so important. When you drive the ball, you've got three things that can happen. You can get to the bucket, you can draw a foul, or you can drop it off to somebody when help defense occurs. And I also think with the three, and Marquette's a very aggressive team, when a ball's reversed and you're going to use the three, start it out with a shot fake. Get that guy up in the air, and then you've got 5-on-4. So there's some things that Cincinnati, with that lead, that could be a huge lead right now. And Marquette's got to be able to get something going on the offensive end, not just what they're doing with the break. Cincinnati's done a really good job setting up the zone, and Marquette's basically stayed on the perimeter rather than trying to get inside with it on the dribble.
Dugan for three. Offensive rebound for Crowder. Forces it back up, draws the foul. So that will put Jay Crowder at the free throw line. JaQuon Parker is called for the personal. That's his first. And team foul number 6 against Cincinnati. Jay Crowder has been in double figures 25 out of the 29 games that Marquette has played. 9 double-doubles. 5 double-doubles in his last 10 games, and just over the last 2 weeks, he's been the conference player of the week in the Big East 2 weeks in a row. And on Friday night, when Buzz Williams suspended Junior Cadogan, Darius Johnson Odom, Todd Mayo, for a portion of the game, all of those players missed at least a half. It was basically Jay Crowder doing the best he could with backups to keep them in the game against West Virginia, and then the cavalry came in the second half, and Marquette won a really tough game on the road in Morgantown.
I never was a big believer in suspension. I thought that if you got upset with kids, you gave him some sprints and made him run, and then that way you don't hurt anybody else. Suspension sometimes creates martyrdom.
Jackson operates inside.
And see, there was a classical example of being able to move with the ball inside without going against help defense. They left Jackson to be guarded by one guy. He put the ball on the floor three times, and that should never happen inside.
Johnson Odom penetrates, but lost it. Taken away by Jeremiah Davis.
Now, great move that Wright made, slowing it down there, so they get a chance to run their offense rather than trying to enforce something. That's the kind of thing you like to see a guard do, is get the offense set.
Tried to hit Davis on the wing. Another good sign might be for Cincinnati as we take a look at Justin Jackson. They've outscored Marquette by 10 in the paint already.
All right, now let's watch Jackson in here. Move one, two, three, four. Four chances with the dribble without somebody doubling up on him and making him throw it back out. If that's going to happen, get the ball to him every time.
Last time these two teams met, much of it was in transition and layups and dunks at the rim. But Marquette scored 50 points in the paint in beating Cincinnati back on February 11th. Hadouken blocked inside. Second effort won't go. Jackson got a hand in. And here comes Cashmere Wright.
Wright did a great job backing off there. That was a really, really smart move. Before things were getting a little bit out of hand, I've really been impressed with Wright and the way he controls things offensively when he's got the ball. Makes a lot of good moves.
Jackson, no look pass. Dixon's foul. Jay Crowder is going to be called for the personal. That's his second.
All right, here they're doing a really good job inside, and they've got to be able to penetrate a little bit and bring the defense up off the baseline. Right now, the bottom part of that 2-3 zone, the bottom three, is able to stay and work very close to the basket.
Darius Johnson Odom back in, Vander Blue back out for Marquette, and maybe an adjustment made by Mick Cronin during that last timeout, as since the under eight TV timeout, now with 5.5 minutes to go here in the first half, every offensive possession for Cincinnati has gone inside. They haven't shot a three since we mentioned it going away to the last commercial.
You're keeping close track of that. Now that's what Marquette has to do. They move the ball one way, they got it inside and looked, and now let's see what they do the next time down if they work on getting it inside. Don't pass the ball to the corner unless he can shoot it or drive it. Keep it out of that corner. Good move by Dixon.
There's the drive by Parker.
Cincinnati's done a great drive after you talked about his shooting threes, Bob. That was really good. Really good speech, I think you made.
Now, I'm glad to know they have our broadcast pumped into their huddle. Clearly, I'm having an impact. Crowder from the corner.
No.
Way short. Tapped out by Wilson.
Now, the key to this game right now, Bob, is that Cincinnati's operating with a 9-point lead and they have the ball. They want to make sure that they don't lose any of that lead. Now, how do you do that? Well, you don't throw the ball away. You're not careless. You work like they have been at driving and getting to the free throw line, and you be very aggressive in your half-court defense. Get somebody in the middle against that zone press. Get somebody high in the middle.
Parker drives it again, and he is able to draw the foul.
The thing that they're doing that's so good that Cincinnati is doing, they're above the baseline. The baseline is the best defensive player in the game, and they're above it. They're 8-10 feet above it, which means they can fake middle, go baseline, fake baseline, and go middle. And that's the most important position in offensive play, is the offense above the baseline.
A 1-1 for Parker, and he gets the bounce. You know, it's interesting. Cincinnati lost JaQuon Parker to a torn groin muscle in their second exhibition game. So he was gone for basically the first 2 months. It exactly coincided with the game where they had the fight against Xavier. And they came out of the fight against Xavier and won 7 or 8 games in a row. And everyone said, boy, that really galvanized them. And Nick Cronin said, no, we got JaQuon Parker back. It just happened to be the exact same time.
Those kind of things like the fight are always over-exaggerated, I think, in terms of what they result in. And you're absolutely right. The whole thing there was Parker coming back.
And speaking of Parker, here he comes again. Uses the window. He's got 12 here in the first half. Neil Wilson gets tied up. Held ball. Well, they'll call a travel instead. 8 first half turnovers against Marquette, and they are going wild here in Cincinnati. The Bearcats on top by 10.
They're doing a better job, Marquette, getting the ball inside, but Cincinnati is reacting well to it.
Now on Verizon's 4G LTE network.
They've done a really good job with the drive. You know, I want to mention this. A lot of schools have had good players. Not many schools have had 2 great players. Cincinnati has had that in Oscar Robertson and Jack Twyman. And Jack was one of the great end-of-game shooters that ever played the game. Jack Twyman, Jerry West, and John Havlicek, not necessarily in any order. And they just scored on what? Again, the drive. They took it right to the bucket.
And this is Cincinnati's largest lead.
Get those guys moving in and out of the post. Good effort by Marquette there. But it...
Another good defensive effort as Jackson came over and got the 5th block here in the first half for the Bearcats.
Now, I like the Bearcat guards in the last 12, 14 minutes, Bob. They have really, just like that. Now, there's nothing wrong with that shot because he got in there 10 feet. But he did it on the dribble.
Dugan tried to slip one through and miss Wilson.
Okay, we're going to see right here. Good move. Down the floor. Little fake all the way to the bucket. Tip in. Defensive player did really not move at all. Just kind of imitated the Statue of Liberty for a moment. I like this. The way they come down, they take a few seconds to get everybody where they want them, and then they start working.
Wilson or Crowder, both might have gotten a piece.
He had a little chance to make a drop-off pass there when he saw the guy slide over on him a little bit.
Vander Blue with a shot fake. Second effort. Taking away another block this time. It's Justin Jackson again. Kilpatrick swoops in. Jackson on the follow. It's a 9-2 run. Watching Justin Jackson score the 24th paint points in the first half tonight for Cincinnati.
You know, he did a good job coming all the way in. He didn't just rely on the shot being made. He thought, okay, if he misses this drive, I want to be there to tip it in. He was in great position. Now, Cincinnati has obviously worked very hard at not getting beat down the floor by Marquette like they did in their last game.
Jackson looking for another shot block. This time he's called for the foul. And that will put Jay Crowder at the line.
Marquette, the last 5 or 6 minutes, Bob, has done a pretty good job of getting the ball inside. They just haven't been able to convert anything, which is a little bit of a testimony to the inside play of the Cincinnati defense, but they're also getting help.
And Marquette this year has specialized in comebacks, especially second half comebacks. Saturday, a full day of college basketball on ESPN ends with 2 great games. First at 7 Eastern, North Carolina and Duke, as the Tar Heels will look to avenge their last second loss from earlier this season And then at 9 Eastern, Texas takes on Thomas Robinson of Kansas. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV at 7 Eastern on ESPN, ESPN3, streaming live on WatchESPN.com and the WatchESPN app.
We talked about Cincinnati about 4 minutes ago, 3.5 minutes ago, retaining that 9-point lead. Not only did they do that, but they've upped it by 4 points.
Cincinnati led the first meeting between these two teams early, 16-4, and then basically got run out of the building.
But Dixon did a good job there, and that's just what they don't need. What's that now, 14?
They made their first, and they are now 1-for-14 from the three-point line.
Dixon did a great job holding up on the drive and backing it out. They still had 15 seconds left to work to get a drive, bring their offense up a little bit. And I just, the way it's going with this game, I wouldn't want any possession to be anything other than an attempted drive.
Padugan to Crowder.
See, that's the first real dribble penetration move Marquette has made against that zone. And it sort of freezes everybody, and they got an opening. Now, they come out in the second half with that kind of penetration. If they knock another couple points off the Cincinnati lead, that's going to be big.
Parker tries to take Crowder again. This time he gets shut down with 10 on the shot clock. Needs some help, unloads to Dixon. Offensive rebound by Munch.
Dixon missed a shot, but he did a great job being there as a release. Now that was excellent defense against the break by Cincinnati.
Bill Patrick off the steal. Dixon able to bank it home.
Boy, these have been four big, big points going down the wire for Cincinnati. They've reduced it to Marquette having only one possession.
About a second half differential between the shot clock and the game clock.
They're going to maybe take a little bit too much time here because they want to have a chance to get the ball inside and not just wind up with an outside shot.
Foul call. Cadogan tried to turn the corner. And a blocking foul called on Kashmir Wright. His second, and that will put Cadogan at the free throw line.
It was a really good call. But it also was a very good move by Cadogan. He started the drive and then tried to speed it up a little bit. Defensive man leaned into him. That's what dribble penetration does against the zone. It puts you on the line. It gets you in an opportunity where two guys may come to the ball and you've got an opening. And they've done it twice very well here just in the last 30, 35 seconds. That'll be a big factor for him in the second half.
Team foul number 8, so it's a 1-1, and still plenty of time for Cincinnati to draw something up for the last 7.3 seconds. So that's exactly what Mick Cronin will do. We'll step aside for 30 seconds and come back with the closing moments of the first half.
Dave, I'm down low.
Alongside Bob Knight, I'm Bob Wischusen. Wednesday Night Hoops presented by Reese's Peanut Butter Cups. And a big first half for Cincinnati. They have shut down at the defensive end, the top scoring team in the Big East, as Marquette came into tonight averaging 76.5 points a game. They average over 17 assists per game, number 7 in the country. But in both of those categories, Cincinnati has done a terrific job at the defensive end. And a lot of it without Yancy Gates, who went to the bench with 2 fouls only 4 minutes into the first half. This is the last 7 seconds.
Marquette's going to pick up full court, but I think since Cincinnati around, they got that three.
And Parker hit it.
I started to say that Cincinnati is going to get something out of it because they moved their defense up and they didn't have anybody back. That was a great, great shot to have.
It was easily their best offensive weapon.
Well, they did a great job of it. And that the other side of that is when the offense is really good, there's always something that the defense is not doing particularly well. And helping out on defense was what Marquette did very poorly in the second half. There's too much open space for the driver to maneuver in going to the bucket.
Cincinnati 15 of 25 from 2-point land, 2-for-15 from 3-point land, and they also had 11 more field goal attempts in the first half than Marquette did.
They have a good statistical advantage over Marquette right now. Staying in that 2-3 zone. They've got good size up there on top against the zone.
Crowder with the flip. Gets Marquette off to a good start here in the second half, and Buzz Williams wants Pratt.
You're exactly right about that. That's the one thing they didn't want to get, Cincinnati, get something scored against them right away. But now they're going to be able to get something against this press.
Forces Dixon to call timeout. We'll step aside quickly as Mick Cronin's team pressured into spending a timeout 27 seconds into the second half.
North Carolina Duke at 7, Texas Kansas at 9.
The first meeting to Cincinnati and ended up winning going away 95-78. I was actually at the game where they were down, got blitzed by Louisville 18-2 to start the game at home and dominated the game the rest of the way. And they were down 15 early in the second half on Friday night at West Virginia and came back to win as well.
They don't need to hurry at all, but they do need. There's a drive again. Good shot there.
Dixon wide open. Gates back outside to right for three. In and out.
Here we go again. Two shots and no score.
Stolen by Dixon on the kick out by Wilson.
Cincinnati's got good spread. They're letting either Dixon or Wright handle the ball up there, and they're spreading and moving inside.
Parker, a floater in the lane, comes up short. Crowder the rebound. Crowder steps into a three. And Gates has it fall right into his hands.
Cincinnati's had three possessions here without a score.
Dixon shovels one off to Parker with the shot fake. And Crowder takes it away as JaQuon Parker couldn't hit. Numbers now for Marquette.
Parker was afraid of a block. You just can't be worried about the block. You've got to go up strong with the shot. Just exactly like Marquette did with going up strong for the shot. Johnson Odom didn't worry about a block. He didn't worry about, he got it up strong. Whereas at the other end, Parker was worried about a block, and that really cost him a big bucket.
A little floater on the baseline. Score the bucket for Sean Kilpatrick. Plus the foul as Johnson Odom will be called for the personal and a chance for a three-point play. Johnson Odom, that's his second.
That, I think, and it's hard to put with a game for Cincinnati right there. They got the bucket. They needed a basket badly.
When you're a team with a double-digit lead, what are the biggest dangers? What are the biggest pitfalls that are lurking out there?
Well, I think you can become too conservative. I think you can become standing around. There isn't anything wrong with using up clock, but you've got to have really good, strong movement when you're doing so.
Kadugan couldn't hit. Vanderblue, and it's stripped away by Dixon. Right to Wilson. Kadugan caught for the loose ball again and lost it out of bounds.
You have a tendency, I think, to be careful, but you've got to be careful with quickness. You can't be careful standing around. You've just got to have really sharp movement so when something does develop an opening for you, you can take advantage of it. Slowing it way down is never a real good answer.
Dixon for three. Got fouled.
Now that is that's as bad a foul as you can commit in a game of basketball. Dixon, it was kind of a half effort at the shot. He went up poorly. He didn't have good control of the ball, and then for him to draw three free throws is just criminal. I'm afraid I'd have had to make a substitution there.
Junior Kadugan called for a second.
Uno.
Since Bob Knight's over here next to me, he's still in the game. As Buzz Williams is going to leave Kadugan on the floor, but for a team that before that three was attempted by Dion Dixon, 2 for 16 from three-point land.
Dose.
And now you put a close to 75% free throw shooter at the line to shoot three.
Trace.
And he's got them all.
How is my Spanish?
I was able to follow along. I didn't even need the sack button on. 17-point lead.
Big play for Bearcats.
Johnson Odom hits a triple. And here comes the pressure for Marquette. Kilpatrick beats it easily. Finds Parker.
If they're going to press, they got to get back a lot quicker than that.
Wilson at the free throw line. In and out. From the corner, knocks down the three. Largest lead for Cincinnati. Another turnover. Parker finds Dixon. And he'll pull it back out. He needs some help as he lost his dribble.
Did a good job getting it out. Wright did a great job coming to the rescue. And then getting everybody set. That very smart basketball by Wright.
Dixon one-on-one picks up his dribble and a foul call. And that's going to go against Cincinnati as Dixon leaned out and created an illegal screen. Still in all, a big lead for the Bearcats.
Yeah, they've done well to start the second half. That screen has got to be set so help out against the drive.
If you were Buzz Williams and your team was down by this number with this group, what would you be telling them?
Well, you just got to keep working, but you got to work within yourself. You can't just come down and think you're going to throw up a bunch of threes. Although that's the second long shot that they've hit, but they've got to be careful about that. Dixon and Wright have done a good job backing it out. They really haven't forced things. They want to keep it out of the corner.
Steal by Crowder, stepped on the sideline. That close to getting the takeaway. But a toe on the line gives it back to Cincinnati.
Big break for Cincinnati right there.
And there was that long diagonal pass to the corner you were talking about.
Don't want to put it in the corner. It's too easy for the defense to double up in the corner or trap the guy down there. Hard to get it out unless you're playing about 10 feet above the baseline. They got to come up a little higher inside. They look like they're setting up in a zone, but they're really playing some man-to-man here. Well, that's the fourth one of those they've missed, Bob.
Wright couldn't hit right at the front of the rim. Now Johnson Odom has to back it out. Crowder will try another three. Too strong. Gates the rebound. Down by 16 with a lot of time left. Not a big fan of the early three.
No, I'm not. Let's drive it. Let's get to the one and one as quick as we can. Let's get some fouls. Let's have an opportunity to score both from the floor and the free throw line.
There's a foul called against Marquette. It'll go against Wilson on the baseline. That's his third. Thursday night, ESPN has a college basketball doubleheader. First at 7 Eastern, Tim Hardaway Jr. in Michigan will take on Illinois. And then at 9 Eastern, it's Georgia against number one Kentucky. The Thursday night showcase presented by T. Rowe Price on ESPN. ESPN3 also streaming live at watchESPN.com and the Watch ESPN app on Thursday night. JaQuon Parker gets a round of applause as he goes to the bench. Gates.
Oh, going to be a goaltend.
And that'll be Jackson with basket interference as he just came on replacing JaQuon Parker.
That might have gone in. That was rolling around up there. That might have gone. That was not a good move. That was dancing there on the rim and he should have let it go. Marquette's had four fouls this half. That's something to watch to see how quickly Cincinnati gets into the one and one.
Cadugan with a pull up. Hit the backboard first. Tapped around and it ends up with Cashmere Wright. Wright with Dixon to help. Lays it in.
That was a great touch by Dixon. He avoided the foul and consequently the bucket counted.
Buzz Williams wants a timeout. We know Marquette is not only going to be in the NCAA tournament, but be a relatively high seed. They're ranked seventh in the country. This game, though, could really impact things for Cincinnati. Even if you would consider them on the bubble, and our own Joe Lenardi really does not, Cincinnati with this win would almost put the exclamation point on their resume for the NCAA tournament, and they have a chance still to possibly get a double bye for the Big East tournament at Madison Square Garden. With a win tonight, as they close out the season against Villanova, they would also need a little bit of help. They need Notre Dame and Georgetown to lose, or Notre Dame or Georgetown to lose one, and a South Florida loss as well. So they need, it's kind of like an NFL playoff scenario going on the last couple of weekends. They need some help in front of them, but most importantly for their overall NCAA tournament resume, this would be a real clincher if they hold on and beat Marquette. And they get another deflection and a turnover on the steal by Jackson.
We've talked about a pass fake. There was no pass fake there. He just brought the ball back and threw it, and the defense reacted to right where the ball was. Use that pass fake. Look one way, fake the pass one way, bring it back the other way, get yourself open. That's a good move inside right there.
Gates needs help. Tough fadeaway, and it's an air ball. Here comes Crowder. Off to Johnson Odom. Blocked by Jackson. His seventh of the night.
Cincinnati, Bob, as you've already indicated, has done a great job getting back the defense. He came from out of nowhere to block that shot. Jackson just really busted his tail getting down the floor.
Crowder slips through to score an easy pick.
All right, I think they're going to set up. I think Buzz has just come out and set up in a 2-3 zone. This is the second time we've seen him in this. Going to be a little bit more difficult for him to drive against the zone, but they still have to penetrate that zone instead of relying on threes.
Shot clock down to 10. Kilpatrick skips one to Dixon for three. Johnson Odom, like lightning the other way, tries to answer and draws a foul. And that one will be called against Kashmir Wright, I believe.
Now, that possession for Marquette was absolutely typical of the way they can get the ball back down the floor in a hurry. They were there almost before Cincinnati had gotten anybody down there, and that's how they drew the foul.
Second leading scorer in the Big East, and the leading scorer in the Big East in conference games only is Darius Johnson Odom. But Derek Wilson will come back on for Marquette, as will Parker and Shekmuj for Cincinnati. Yancy Gates and Jackson sit down. Johnson Odom already up to 14 points tonight, but he has not gotten a lot of help from his teammates. He and Crowder have scored 29 of Marquette's 40.
If Marquette stays in this 2-3 zone, Bob, Cincinnati is going to have to get a high-low situation inside where they've got two guys going up and down. Now they're going to have to be there. They got, didn't get it high enough. They're lucky there. Get it up in the air to the big guy. Still in the 2-3 zone. Missed him inside.
Parker will drive it, kick it to the corner for Dixon. And the rebound to Jamil Wilson. Mayo, a little Euro step with the left hand.
The 2-3 zone is causing some problems for the Bearcats right now. The press isn't doing much. It's slowing the game down a little bit, which doesn't hurt Cincinnati, but they get back in that 2-3 quickly.
There is a lot of time left for a team that's as explosive offensively as Marquette is.
That's where they have to go. They've got to go to the postman coming up. He either has something like that or he can punch it down. They've got to keep doing that. They've got to make the pass inside.
Crowder from the wing, way short. Right the rebound. He's got a hit ahead to Parker. And he'll go to the free throw line to look to add to his career high.
All right, here's a pass to the inside. When he turns, he's set up for the shot, or he can dump it inside. That's what they've got to do.
February 11th, only 42 tonight. They turned it over 14 times in the first meeting. And tonight, only 5 turnovers, and the game is just about 3/4 over.
One of the things that I did always worry about was beating somebody relatively easily, like Marquette did Cincinnati at Marquette, and then playing them again, whether it was home, away, or whatever it was. It's tough to get today's kid thinking in such a way that they've got to play their best to beat somebody that they've just beaten by quite a bit. That's a hard thing for coaches to do today.
Held ball. Possession arrow gives it back to Cincinnati as Vander Blue got tied up. Juan Anderson back in, replacing Jamil Wilson for the Golden Eagles.
Cincinnati didn't want to get too many guys down here on this end of the floor. Get Gates back inside. Get somebody else up on the high post.
Parker drives it again. Fades away. And a foul call. And that'll go against Yancy Gates. And Yancy Gates needs to be careful. The last thing Cincinnati needs here is to pick up a technical foul.
They almost got it.
That's the third on Gates.
When a big kid like that gets the ball inside, no matter what, you've just got to fake and go up with it, because there's a pretty good chance of you drawing a foul if you don't come close to making the bucket.
Johnson Odom launches a three. That's way short. And Parker's got it. Outlets to Dixon. Cashmere right for three. Johnson Odom comes away with it.
That's just what you don't want right there.
On his way up, they wave off the basket, and it looks like a foul might be called out on the wing against Dion Dixon. That's his second.
That may have saved him as much as the three-point swing right there, that foul on Dixon.
So both teams with under 10 minutes to go here in the second half, with a couple of fouls still to give before either reaches the bonus. And Marquette starting to run out of time. They've come from behind by double digits a bunch this year. That'll help. Wilson hits a three from the corner, and it's a 15-point game with 9:14 to go.
Now they're a point under what their lead was at the half. Let's see how much of that Marquette can continue to knock off. I never wanted to lose what our halftime lead was. I always thought that we're getting into a dangerous position then. Now they've gone back to man-to-man, which should work to, I think, to Cincinnati's advantage.
Dixon throws it away. Well, now they're going to say it was tipped. The initial call was that it was out of bounds off Dixon, but it looks like Junior Cadugan deflected the ball.
That's really good officiating, because sometimes an official is just in a position where he can't really see what happened. And one official came across and the other accepted it very quickly. They did a good job with that.
Shot clock at 5. Parker has it. He'll drive it with the shot clock at 2 and lay it in.
Now that's a drive that you absolutely have to stop. That's where, again, Marquette will look at this, and they'll spend a lot of time on help defense.
Vander Blue from the corner. Foul called, and it's going to go against Marquette. Jay Crowder picks up the foul.
Okay, here we're seeing Parker with the move. He takes it all the way to the bucket. Marquette doesn't help, and that's a big basket for Cincinnati.
That foul on Jay Crowder is his third. Cashmere Wright out for Cincinnati. G. Long Gwynn back in. And Jay Crowder now with three fouls with 8.5 minutes to go, down by 17. Marquette is on the ropes.
This becomes a one-on-one game now to get the ball into play. And they're in man-to-man again, which I think works to Cincinnati's advantage. Against the zone, maybe they can take up a little bit more time. But here they've got some great opportunities to drive.
Parker has it slapped away, right back in his hands. Shot clock at 8. Dixon backs it out. A contested three. That missed everything.
You don't want to wind up with that.
Mayo. Offensive rebound, Vander Blue. Cadogan tries a triple.
No.
That's no good. Offensive rebounds. Blue lost it on the way up. And here's Dixon ahead of the field. Throws it down.
Big, big bucket there.
Another timeout called by Buzz Williams.
Every time that Marquette has got something going, Cincinnati has done a great job answering to it, keeping the lead where it is. Right now, they're still 3 points ahead of what they were at the half. Slip out. And it wasn't just a slip out. It was a man with the ball really, really looking to make the pass.
Well, Dion Dixon closing in on 1,200 points for his career. Yancy Gates nearing 1,400 points. Both of those. And this win for a Cincinnati team, if they can hold on in the last 7.5 minutes, is a big stamp on the resume as we head towards Selection Sunday and first the Big East tournament at the Garden next week. That's an Odom foul by Parker.
Good recovery by Parker. He committed the foul. He didn't come in low enough and get spread. He committed the foul with his hands.
Second foul on Parker, but a big lead for Cincinnati, closing in on 7 minutes to go. You wonder if this is too deep a hole for the Golden Eagles to dig out of. Bob Wischusen alongside Bob Knight. And it's been a very clean game played by Cincinnati as well. Only 5 turnovers.
They played very well. They've got a 10 margin in turnovers.
The Dugan down the lane. It's the floater.
They moved to help, but they didn't close the gap, and he was able to split them. Now Marquette is doing just what Cincinnati did to get the lead. And that's looking for a gap that they can drive. Ooh, I think he did. I think that's a good call.
Wally Ratecki was right on the midcourt stripe and called the over and back.
Yep, that's a good call. We're looking right at it from here. You cannot back up when you're trying to maintain a lead and work like Cincinnati is. You've got to be at least 6 feet inside of the 10-second line. So if you do have to go back, you're not in danger of what just happened.
Vander Blue, the finger flip won't go. Nancy Gates with the rebound. Tied up, foul call. And if that's called against Crowder, that's his fourth. Well, now Jay Crowder's got 4 fouls.
Now that's actually a good call for Cincinnati, although they're not shooting. It gives them a chance to run a half a minute off the clock and then still wind up with a chance to score. Don't get 3 guys over there.
Gwynn gets it across. Dixon with a tough catch. Finds Gates.
They handle the press really well. That foul that was drawn down at the other end was worth the 2 points score. They took away the drive with their defense.
Cadogan lost it again. Wynn's got it. Taken back, though, on the dive by Crowder. What a hustle play by Jay Crowder. Johnson Odom for three. Knocks it down. And a timeout called by Marquette.
That was a bad possession to lose there, Bob. They had just gotten that good bucket against the press, and now they're going to get it, and they could be, you know, 5.5 to go with two that Marquette didn't get.
Great hustle play late by Jay Crowder to keep the possession alive for Marquette and allow them to eventually score on the triple by Johnson Odom. Now, is there enough time? 5.5 minutes to go for a team that can score in bunches and can press, but down by 16.
It depends on how well Cincinnati can handle the ball and get to the free throw line. Right now, Marquette has played Cincinnati exactly even in the second half. And that's a pretty good job that Marquette has done, or that Cincinnati has done, staying in control now for a total of almost 35 minutes in the game. Now, this will be a lot of what Cincinnati can do. You want to be careful about giving Gates the ball because he's not real good with it in any way. Now, this should be a 30-second time-consuming possession here. Cincinnati's going to have to play against that man-to-man. They're going to have to look for the drive.
Dribbling by Wright, goes behind the back, flips it off to Dixon, who walked.
Dixon was in too tight. When a driver starts to go, whether it's Parker or Dixon or who it is, you've got to move out a little bit so that when the defense collapses, he's got a little drop-off pass. And if the defense doesn't collapse, then he's got a chance to go to the bucket. Cincinnati has really wasted its last two possessions, and they just can't do that.
Only their sixth turnover. It did take 30 seconds off the clock, but Marquette's got it back. Johnson Odom flips it to the corner for Crowder. Comes up short. Gates able to pull it down in traffic.
Big rebound. Big rebound.
11 rebounds on senior night for Yancy Gates. Kilpatrick. No good. And it's out of bounds off Dixon.
See that? That shot only used up 7 seconds on the clock. And you just can't do that at this point in the game. Keep it. They're going to draw a foul now. If you start holding the ball, backing it out, look to drive, they're going to reach. You're going to get to the foul line.
In and out for Wilson. Those are the shots Marquette now needs to hit in order to make a comeback happen.
That's a really tricky handoff on the sideline like that. Get the ball centered. As soon as you get across midcourt when you've got this lead, get the ball centered. Oh, almost a carry.
Shot clock at 10.
They need something good here. Get to the lane or get a bucket.
Gates, shot clock at 3. He's going to have to put it up. Shot clock at 1 with the left hand that rolls off. The tip follow won't go. And here comes Johnson Odom. Mayo drives it, draws the foul. Looks like that might go against JaQuon Parker. That is his third. Cincinnati still with a sizable lead. Marquette trying to claw their way back in it, running out of time. And it's basically been the same deficit the entirety of the second half for Marquette that they faced at halftime.
Well, they're going to be two ahead when he makes his free throw for the second half.
Oh,
one
you
ahead.
Them.
Get it out of there. They're putting it in bad spots.
Almost get the steal, but Gates rips it away. And now Cashmere
Wright
will
slow it up. That was a good move. That was a good move to hold it. But oh, they got to draw a foul here. Yeah, they got it. They've only shot 6 free throws this half. And every possession after 4 minutes, you should have something that takes you to the free throw line so you can make those two without any problem.
Todd Mayo called for the foul. That's only his first. And while we were away, you were talking about what you think the keys are for Cincinnati and how they need to run their offense in the last 3.5 minutes when you're up a sizable portion.
Well, I really believe the last 10 minutes Cincinnati should have been up high. They should have had nobody below the foul line extended, including the center. And then that way you've really improved your driving angles. The high post man may slide down and back up, but give yourselves a lot of room. That's only the eighth free throw they've shot in the second half with the kind of lead they've had. They should have shot 20 by this time.
Crowder. It's Yancy Gates to commit his fourth foul, and Jay Crowder will go to the free throw line. And Saturday, a full day of college hoops on ESPN, ends with two great games at 7 Eastern. North Carolina looking to avenge their last second loss to their bitter rival Duke. And then at 9 Eastern, Texas takes on Thomas Robinson in Kansas. Two great games Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV at 7 Eastern Saturday night on ESPN, ESPN3, and streaming live on WatchESPN.com and the WatchESPN app.
Cincinnati really wants to work at getting the ball in quickly here. Don't miss it. Nope, bounced in. They've got good depth. They're going to be all right there.
Kilpatrick, tough catch in the corner, finds Dixon. Here's Gates, throws it down.
That was a great play by Gates. Great balance for a big kid.
Cadogan turns it over again.
Now, that was excellent by Dixon. Run some clock off. You're going to draw a foul here. Get up high. They're still too low. Get off the baseline when you've got a lead. Come up to the foul line, extend it.
Shot clock under 10. Shot clock down to 3. Dixon launches. It's a miss, but it took 35 seconds off the game clock. Johnson Odom. Too strong. Cadogan hustles for the loose ball and has it in his hands. Throws it down low. And Jamil Wilson able to dunk it home. 2 minutes to go.
You don't want to have a possession this late in the game where you don't get to the free throw line. That's what happens if you bring it up high. Then you've got room to drive and you're going to draw the foul. I think Marquette's just said, let's get it over with.
Shot clock at 3. Cashmere right to the corner. Dixon got it off in time. That's a shot clock violation. But I'm not sure we've seen a team more effectively break the pressure of Marquette this year than Cincinnati has tonight.
Well, they've done a really good job with it. But then they need to do something at this end. They have not taken advantage of the foul situation whatsoever or created the two-shot foul early enough. And you get that, as I've said 3 or 4 times now, by bringing your offense up as high as the foul line extended is, then everybody has a chance to drive, and there's nobody clogging up the basket. And if the big man slides to help, then our big man is moving into the middle of the lane where he can get an easy bucket.
Fadeaway won't go for Blue. As Buzz Williams has certainly waved the white flag now as he has taken Jay Crowder and Darius Johnson Odom both out of the game for the last minute 12. Mayo for 3, rolls it home.
Cincinnati basically has done a really, really good job with their 2-3 zone.
Parker fouled by Mayo. So JaQuon Parker will go to the line to try and add to what has been the night of his life as Cincinnati. RPI 76, schedule strength 134, doesn't represent a really good out-of-conference schedule, obviously, but when you've beaten Georgetown, you've beaten Louisville, now you're going to beat the number 7 team in the country at home. They were, according to Joe Lenardi at least, our bracketologist, in the tournament tonight going in.
You've got to look at the strength of the team within its conference, particularly when it's a conference as good as the Big East is. And that record they've had in the conference has been very, very good. I think that they've more than earned their opportunity to go on with just what their play in the conference has been.
And Dion Dixon on senior night gets a curtain call, and we expect the same for Yancy Gates before the game ends. For the takeaway. Crowd chanting Yancy Gates' name. Cashmere Wright dribbling the clock down, 15 to shoot. Lobs one up. Gates misses the alley-oop.
Go up with two hands. Don't try to do something that's just a little bit more spectacular. Do it with two hands and you don't miss it.
Blue's got the loose ball in the corner. Forces one up. Another loose ball grabbed by Marquette. Wilson back outside to Blue. Hits a three and a quick timeout called by Mick Cronin as he wants Yancy Gates to have. Cincinnati. An 11-point victory for the Bearcats, and it was more lopsided than the final score would indicate. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Bob Knight, I'm Bob Wischusen. So long from Cincinnati.
All right, so big win by Cincinnati there. Meanwhile, good one in Louisville.